The tech companies that develop apps work towards this objective. How can we design the interface so that people not only check daily, but consistently? In order to answer this riddle, they've recruited the help of neuroscientists. Why? Well, neuroscientists have esoteric knowledge about the addictive facets of the brain and how to cue triggers that will create dependent behaviors. It's kind of like Pavlov's theory of conditioning, except for instead of a dinner bell, it's a... The word addiction is derived from a Latin term for enslaved by or bound to. And as some of you already know, when engaged in certain activities, the brain releases dopamine. This word came up a lot during my research, and I decided to look into it further and gain a better understanding of it. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter, and it's associated with the brain's reward and pleasure centers. It assists the body in regulating movement and motor functions, hence a deficiency in it can sometimes lead to Parkinson's. And low levels can actually make the brain more prone to addiction. One of its receptors is associated with motivation or seeking out certain sensations in a compulsive manner. Here's the menacing side of dopamine. Whether it's a piece of chocolate, a line of cocaine, receiving a text message, a hit of nicotine, getting more likes, a shot of heroin, email alert. All of these activities equally cause a secretion of dopamine in the brain. So the hippocampus then correlates this activity with it being pleasurable and worthy of seeking out again and again. A conditioned response to that stimuli is born and a habit is formed. It matters not if the activity is healthy or harmful. The brain does not differentiate. It could be drugs, okay? Alcohol, gambling, shopping, and or the plethora of phone notifications. And I also discovered that teens are a lot more sensitive to dopamine than adults are. Our sympathetic system, that fight or flight response, is being triggered all the time, indirectly by these notifications, and it's having both a physiological as well as a psychological effect. It has been estimated that people in the U.S. check their phones 50, 80, upwards to 150 times a day, varying between age groups. Parents, do you remember the freedom that we had as kids to leave our house and just be out in the world? When I was a youngin', my friends would have to call abuela's house or grandma's house to get a hold of me.
Ay, pero como joden por teléfono, mi madre, ay, no bolide. Oigo.
Hello, is Elizabeth home?
Who is speaking, please?
Hi, this ¿Cómo? Is Heather.
Heather. Okay. I tell her you call. Okay. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye-bye.
I'd be out and about, riding my bicycle around the neighborhood, playing hide-and-go-seek, digging for buried treasure in the backyard. And some children don't know what that creative and unstructured autonomy of play feels like without a cell phone. And that is truly disheartening to me. Children are now equally as obligated to be connected as we are. And the average age for them to have a cell phone in the States is 10. Most of you by now have seen the scenario. Entire families and groups of friends sitting physically together and yet virtually apart. Some people sleep right next to their phones, on. They'll look at it the moment they wake up, before formulating an original thought, or simply thinking, Lord, oh Lord, I live to see another day. Hallelujah! It has been estimated by the National Safety Council that a whopping 78% of distracted drivers on the road are due to texting. And it accounts for one out of every four car accidents in the U.S. A vehicle is a form of transportation, yes, but it can also potentially be a weapon. Some of you may already know from experience or close calls that time simply does not elapse in the same way when you're driving and looking down at your phone. This one day, I'm heading south on the 5, and I receive a text notification. By the time that I sent the response and looked up, to my amazement, I'm next in line at a Starbucks drive-thru.
I'm kidding. It's a joke. I'm kidding.
Now, there may not be a monetary cost to joining a social media platform, but it is far from free. Your payment is basically allowing yourself to be monitored and having these sophisticated algorithms calculate the probability of your behavior. It is not a coincidence that the Facebook newsfeed is a never-ending, scrolling pit of mostly trivial information with the occasional pearl of wisdom. This is an intentional part of the design to keep you there for as long as you allow yourself to be. Why? Well, the longer that you stay in these apps, the more information that's gathered about your browsing patterns, and that will help tailor the advertisements that you're exposed to. And you're probably thinking, well, yeah, that's not a big deal. But you know what? I would say it is, because this is part of the behavioral conditioning. The amount spent on advertisements has nearly doubled in the last 2 years to 31 billion. Not pesos, dollars. That is B as in Bravo, not M as in Mary. And I find it hard to believe that there is innocence or even neutrality behind an intention with that many zeros. Some of you guys may recall the not too distant days in which cell carriers would charge based on actual talk time. You remember there were peak hours and then it became free on the weekends. You could talk to your heart's content. And at the end of each month, there would be a variable surprise in the mail. You could be paying $80, $120, $260. How much more efficient would we be in conversation if we were still being charged by the minute? How less frivolous would we be with our internet browsing if we paid by the hour? Unlimited text and talk is the virtual equivalency of opening up Pandora's box. It was confirmed by Sprint that a 14-year-old girl sent and received 35,463 text messages in a month. And not on one occasion, on two. That's almost 1,200 a day. Simon Sinek, I think that's how you pronounce his last name, he made a great point during an interview. In the States, we have age limits for potentially addictive activities, right? So you have to be 18 to buy cigarettes and smoke. You have to be 21 to buy alcohol and drink. Well, these are the age requirements for social networks. Users now have to be 16 to use WhatsApp. And almost all other social networks require users to be 13 years of age. This includes Facebook, Snapchat, Twitter, Instagram, and Skype. 13! This age requirement is much lower for something that is equally as addictive as drugs. But in reality, any age can open a social networking account by simply answering yes when asked if they meet the age requirements. Even if they have to do some basic math on the date of birth, they could do it. Same thing with pornography sites, so I've been told. The average age that a child will see their first pornography video is 11. In my opinion, children do not yet have the emotional maturity to understand the consequences of the use of technology and social media. I mean, let's be honest, adults barely do. Think of the irresponsible behavior and your infantile ways of thinking when you were younger. Let me be very clear, neither texting nor social media is bad in and of itself. The danger comes from the prioritization and the disproportionate use of it. Alcohol in moderation, socially, it's not a bad thing. However, excessive consumption makes it toxic. Or when you're hangry, food gives you tremendous pleasure when you start eating it, but if you continue to eat, it'll make you sick. Same thing applies to technology. My hypothesis, part of the reason for this imbalance is the absence of a cap. So whether you talk and text 24/7 for that whole month straight, or you don't use a phone at all, the payment is exactly the same. It's like going to an all-you-can-eat buffet, and you're going to have that 11th egg roll, not because you're hungry, just because you want to feel like you got your money's worth. Snapchat, one of the most popular applications for adolescents, has a function called streaks. Now, a streak is the consecutive number of days in which a person communicates with another person. I consider this feature to be a form of psychological preying on our youth. Is this not so? To have them strive to increase this number more and more each day? This frivolous number that literally means nothing, nada, except for the value placed on it in the child's mind. It adds absolutely no benefit to their life and is causing unnecessary anxiety. 20-year studies are now being conducted on teens to determine the long-term effects that this is having on their developing nervous systems. The reserve of dopamine in the brain is finite, and once it's been depleted, depression sets in. Ironically though, two of the most influential people in tech, Bill Gates, founder of Microsoft, and Steve Jobs, founder of Apple, may he rest in peace, they would limit the amount of time that their children spent with technology. The very technology that they created. Clearly, they were privy to the potential consequence from the very beginning. These medias have the potential to do good in the world, and yes, they've done plenty good. Reunited lost friends and family, helped communities rebuild. I mean, the internet houses a wealth of knowledge, information to encourage and to elevate the mind, the ability to advocate and collaborate on innovations. It's a brilliant side of its use, to learn, to satisfy curiosity, avenues to reach higher thinking. But the subjective question becomes, and this is a rhetorical question, do the pros outnumber the cons? They say that technology is neutral.
Bullshit! Oh, excuse me.
Now, they say the technology is neutral. If so, then why do you need brain scientists, son? Why are there reward simulations when using technology that is literally changing both the structure and functionality of the human brain? Like the root of most things, and it comes down to profit. For the love of money, people will steal from their brothers. Don't let money change you. Sorry, I had a New Jack City moment. These companies are all about the Bendermans. What? They're not taking into consideration what impact this is having on society when they develop these things. It's all about profit. It is simply another marketing scheme to create more imaginary needs in the minds of consumers. A mobile is a tool, an instrument, and it should not have the power to seduce so much attention from its owner. It has been said that more exploration time on Facebook increases depression. That could possibly be due to the comparison factor. We see all the happy families, couples, holiday photos, but we forget that it is only half the truth. People only show highlights of their life, but we take it as though it were the complete image, and it's not. One day, a coworker and I went out for drinks after work, and he confided in me that he and his wife had not been intimate for about 6 months. A week later, I see a photo on Facebook with the whole family, you know, white collar shirts, matching blue jeans. What would have been more honest, perhaps, is a photo of himself in a pair of boxer shorts with an erection asking, "Can you help a brother out?" If the civil rights movement, the feminist movement, massive revolutions have been orchestrated without cell phones, then our insistence that we need it for daily life is simply not true. It is a psychological vice and a false sense of obligation to be available all the time. The dopamine release compounds this feeling and keeps us in this endless cycle. People who lose or break their cell phone actually get to feel a temporary relief of digital detox. Is it any wonder that there are group retreats that cost more than $500, which force participants to surrender their phone while they channel their inner child, running around in the woods, burning bushes like they're in Zelda? The fact that we're paying to be forced offline is evidence that we are unable to govern ourselves.
No, Elizabeth, you are wrong. It's a choice. You just have to exercise your will. I can stop whenever I want to.
Yeah, listen here, Buttercup.
Buttercup.
Not everyone can do that. Our brains are being chemically manipulated. It's not your fault. It's not a matter of just will. Nobody started using a cell phone with the intention of becoming addicted, but many of us got caught up in the hype. Our vulnerabilities as humans, being susceptible to patterns and habits, is being exploited. And the result is this behavior. It is not a choice for some of us. It is a full-blown addiction. It's like a domino effect. Monkey see, monkey do. You see a person pull out their phone and it triggers you.
Instagram, bananas, Snapchat.
This behavior is unraveling the very tapestry of natural and organic human interaction.